Good afternoon, everyone. I am Uma Bokil, co-author, editor, and compiler, all the way from Ink Feathers Publishing. And today I have someone really special with me. Since all of us know that modern day relationships keep getting worse or better day by day, but we can't ignore the fact about all the toxicity or all the pain and all the negatives that come along with it. Especially now that social media has chosen to define relationships in so many what must be's and what's supposed to be's. And in all of this, it's hard for us to find one common ground where we actually find out what it is that we want. And the person that I have today with me, she is an author of a book of poems which talk about the exact same thing. May it be the toxic traits that are in relationships, may it be the modern day norms and guidelines of what has defined a relationship today. We will be talking and discussing about the book and her in general. So please welcome Deepika Bharadwaj, the author of a book called Subtle. Hi Deepika, how are you?
Hi, I'm good. I'm an author of Subtle, and I've also co-authored in various other poet anthologies. One of them is written in protest, also by Ink Feathers. I am an MBBS student currently, and I've always been a spectator when it comes to relationships. I've always been someone who's spectating over two people in a relationship or in a quarrel. I'm 21 years old. I do not have a lot of experience when it comes to love, but you know, as a spectator, it's much more easier to find out when and where people are going wrong or what they're doing that's causing a drift. And you know, as a reader, I'm obviously a hopeless romantic, so the difference between expectation and reality has always been a thing that I used to observe a lot.
Right.
So my book is a collection of poems where I've observed these relationships. I've seen what all the toxic traits are, what causes the agony and pain when it comes to separation, and why people do not try to leave even when they know that this is not good for them. And it's a very fun journey, you know, just spectating and being kind of a bitch.
That's amazing. I wanted to actually ask you, first of all, why call it Subtle? And second of all, this is a very common thing that I think almost everybody in a relationship has come across at least one or the other point of time. Why do you think that even though that is the case, people still refuse to openly talk about this, to openly talk about these toxic traits or red flags as we know it?
Subtle, I named the book Subtle because the red flags in a relationship, in a toxic relationship, are very subtle. They're not like when you talk about a toxic relationship, in general, what we think about is physical abuse or sexual abuse or something like that. It is not. It's these small things, these subtle things that tell you, okay, this person is taking you for granted. People don't usually talk about it is because even after ending a relationship, they do not realize that they were in a toxic relationship. And this can very aptly be explained by this psychological theory called this frog syndrome, in which if you put a frog in boiling water, it will jump out of the pot. But if you put a frog in normal or cold water and then start boiling it slowly, the frog won't realize it till the end. And by the time he realizes that the water is boiling, he'll be dead.
Right.
That's what happens in a toxic environment.
That makes sense. That absolutely makes sense. So according to you, now that we have come to this frog syndrome, not does it only sound relatable, I think all of us can relate to it on a very personal level, I included. So according to you, what are these toxic traits or what are these red flags that, you know, we have come across? Maybe some of them are very common, but yet some of them people may not know that they are toxic traits, but they actually do exist as toxic.
Okay. First of all, what people think is, as long as your partner is loyal, they're nice in a relationship. Loyalty, care, attention, effort, these are the bare minimum. It's not a luxury and it shouldn't be treated as like one.
Someone
can be toxic irrespective of whether they're loyal to you or not, or whether they talk to other people or not. One of the main umbrella excuse that toxic people use is, once upon a time when the holy mammoths walked on earth, I had a girlfriend or a boyfriend who dumped me or cheated on me, and now I am not the same anymore. And after this loosely translates to, in the due course of our relationship, I'm gonna be an asshole, a jerk, act up, and when you call me on your bullshit, I'll use this as an excuse. If I had a penny for every time I've heard this line or this statement or this story, I'd be a millionaire.
Right.
If there is no girlfriend or boyfriend, there's always a crush who rejected them.
Yeah.
It's very simple. If you're not over that problem, you shouldn't be in a relationship to start with. And if you're over it, you shouldn't be using it as an excuse for acting up. Then there's one, and this is used as an umbrella. All the other toxic traits, you know, come under this.
Right. So it begins.
Just how I am.
It begins with that particular statement. Yeah. And then before you know it, it's like showering and raining toxicity on you.
And one thing that I think one can do to avoid it is when they tell you sympathize. And once you do sympathize, it's like you've given them the validation that I can use it against you.
Right.
Someone's ex's baggage is not yours to take care of, irrespective of how dark it is.
Absolutely.
It's not yours. Now, after this stems the that's what I am, that's how I am.
Yeah.
And you know, Instagram quotes are the main culprit of it. Bollywood movies and Instagram quotes. Remember that statement, "Koi tumse badal ke pyar kare to wo pyar nahi." Just imagine, you're a 12-year-old. You get into a relationship with someone who's also 12. Now 6 years have passed, and you ask that person to grow up, and this guy or this girl is like, you know, when you got into a relationship, you knew exactly what I was. I was a 12-year-old. Now you can't expect me to grow. Doesn't make sense. When you say, you can't just be like, you can't change me. There's no such thing as changing. There's one thing called improving, then the other thing is called grooming. Grooming is toxic. It's like, it's also used with people who are pedophiles. It's like changing that person to a point that he or she is isolated,
right,
and cannot, you know, interact with anyone else except you. That's not what's happening in majority of the relationships. You're just using this, you shouldn't change me, when someone's trying to positively impact you in your personal growth, knowing well that they probably aren't the end game and probably do not have a future and still are trying to help you out.
That makes
sense. One should normalize the whole, I'm willing to work on that. I acknowledge it and I'm willing to work on it.
Right.
Which is very rare.
Right. So
and causes
there is
a lot of toxicity.
The improving part is more like, you know, there will be a partner who will try to help you grow up to your potential for the benefit of your personality. And that is way different than somebody who's just trying to make you change according to their norms and guidelines. You know how they want you to be. And
you cannot generalize the don't change wala narrative everywhere.
Yes.
That's really hollow of someone to think, I read this quote on Instagram, now I'm not changing. I'll be a 12-year-old for my entire life.
Absolutely. I think this is a completely important point that needs to be put forth, where, you know, it is important to stay true to who you are. It is not the same as somebody who's trying to make you see something for your own improvement sake or for the benefit of you only, because here the part of they care about you comes into the picture. So not everybody who's trying to help you grow is trying to help you change who you are. Maybe they are trying to help you be who you are from where you actually...
If you cannot differentiate a positive change and a negative change and just think that every change is bad, I think you need to work on yourself personally before, you know, getting involved with someone. Then
absolutely.
Then comes a major one called gaslighting.
Mm-hmm.
It's like doing an effed up thing and then coming to you and saying it was your fault. The most common example is, I cheated on you, you weren't giving me time. I abused you because you were acting up. Doesn't make sense, and you're just victim blaming someone.
That is the classic example, is what I believe. If somebody, I've seen this or heard about this or read about this. Classically speaking, when somebody is actually working, really hard to earn a living, let's say, or trying to work on themselves, and maybe this person for the time being is not a priority to them, or the relationship is on a second or a third priority, they actually look at it in such a negative way and they go ahead and cheat on this person just because they weren't physically available, and then come back to the person and like you said, gaslight them by saying that it was your physical absence that caused this. So had you been here physically, I would not have cheated. And that leaves a very doubtful impression on the other person's mind. It completely wraps them up in a, what did I do wrong? I was just trying to live my life. I was improving myself.
It really affects your mental health, because in the next relationship, you probably try to be more physically available for the person, but then that will be at the cost of your growth academically or professionally. And that shouldn't be a burden.
Exactly.
What I've personally seen after gaslighting is that people tend to wash the dirty laundry in public.
Right.
It's like I have a fight and 25 others will be involved, because that other person would go and tell all his or her friends.
Hmm.
And it'll be a whole ruckus. And I get that one person needs to confide in someone when they're emotionally, hurt, but doing that to 25 others is not confiding, is not seeking comfort. It's just spreading rumors.
Yes.
And it's not fair when you probably know that you might get back together. That's very unhealthy.
Very, very. So it's different when you're actually confiding in, a friend, but then when it's creating a scene, or basically after telling a crowd, you're just broadcasting it like a news report, and people know only your side of the story. So and at the end, you're actually creating a very...
Yeah, people turn on the other person.
Yes, they turn on the other person without even knowing the side of their story. So that I agree with you completely. That does end up becoming a horribly toxic trait, which we are most of the times not aware of.
Yeah, people tend to then remember, this person just said this to me, and then spread rumors. And even if they get into a relationship, it'll always be in the back of their mind, and that's just tough.
Very.
Then there's a lack of respect, or, constantly publicly demeaning your other half. This incident happened with one of my friends. We were at a cafe and she was with her boyfriend, and I was with we were friends, and she also brought her boyfriend, and they were having a fight before. And so she refused to eat or something, and this guy starts abusing her in front of the whole table.
Oh my God.
That kind of disrespect is... It should be a deal breaker. It's like you're letting that other person not only take you for granted, but walk all over you.
Exactly.
Insulting someone in public, you don't even do that to anyone, not even to your friends, let alone someone you claim to love.
Absolutely. I don't think anybody has ever picked up a public fight comparatively with their friends as much as I have seen people pick up public fights with their other halves. I mean, even when it comes down to friendships, I know from afar that this is a very toxic friendship that is going to end in a very, very bad way. Because friendship is something that even we look for in a relationship, right? So if you can't handle somebody, or you can't love somebody as a friend, as a person, then it's a completely long lost, distant thing to even love them as a person or a couple or somebody who's with them in a relationship.
Agree. Like, everyone has fights, but one should know when and where to pick up those fights and
absolutely
actually hold grudges. You can't do that in public.
Absolutely.
And I actually saw a video of someone proposing to his girlfriend, and that girlfriend took a violin and slammed it on someone's head.
Oh,
because she
God.
Didn't want to say yes.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
I was like, what the...
those are the funny kind of toxic traits, which we can...
That I won't mind spectating, to be honest.
Some entertainment.
I'd probably be there with a phone.
Right, right. Recording it and having a laugh for the rest of your life. So yeah, I completely agree with you about all the toxic traits that you have mentioned, and I could personally relate to them so much, whether it was a post that I remembered, like you said, or whether it was something that I witnessed or experienced for myself. So I completely am looking even more forward to reading your book. In fact, I'll have you know that I've ordered it, so I'll be getting my copy in a couple of days.
That's really great.
Right.
There are a few other traits, if you allow me. I'll just run through them. There's one called constantly breaking up and catching up that causes a major drift in your relationship, because you're not talking for months and then getting back together for a month and then not talking for a month. Then there's hot and cold treatment, where one gives you attention for a few days and then is ghosts you for the rest of 30 days in a month, 25 days in a month. Then gold digging or exacting revenge. So and so person did this to me, so I'll do the same.
Absolutely. So it's the on and off thing that pisses me off the most, because why? I don't get it. It's a waste of time for me personally. And it's like, it should at least be decisive about it, or just
like
take some time.
Flushing your shit and taking it out all over again.
Yeah. Oh God, I love this example. That completely makes sense. That completely makes sense.
You broke up because you did not have irreconcilable differences.
Right.
The reason for divorces and stuff.
Absolutely, absolutely. In fact, after hearing you talk about all these toxic traits, I was curious to know something. For example, now we all know that every human is not perfect. We come with a lot of flaws, and some of us already know that one part of one person or us even, for example, may be toxic. Maybe it's a small thing or whatever. So obviously there is a huge difference in a person having one or two toxic qualities versus a person being toxic completely. So what would you like to say about that?
See, the thing is, everyone has one or two toxic qualities. Even I'd probably be toxic. One of my exes could come up and say she was toxic in so and so way, and probably would be right. The problem isn't having those toxic traits. The problem is when you are called out and you give that statement, that's just the way I am. It should be that, yes, I get that this was what I'm doing wrong, and I'll work on it. Willingness to improve differentiates you from having a toxic trait and becoming a toxic person.
Right.
And that should be a priority.
That makes, completely. That's healthy. That's completely healthy is what I feel. Because even we as humans, it's completely understandable and normal. We are not born to be cupids, or we're not born as relationship therapists. It's going to take each of us different kinds of time to learn things, learn something about ourselves as well when it comes to a relationship. In fact, I swear by the statement that the more I meet people, or the more a person meets other people, when it is even through the eyes of a date or two dates, that gives them so much of an insight of who they are as people, and that gives them more detailed information about what they are exactly looking for when they are seeking a more serious relationship. And that is a completely healthy approach to keep, because it's completely, you know, it's states that you are looking for a relationship for all the right reasons for you.
Right.
Right. So that is something.
No one can be idealistic. They can only work on what the other person wants and you can do.
Absolutely. So that is a very, I agree with you, that must be a healthy approach, I believe, whenever you are looking at something. It will, I guess, take time, but staying, like you said, not wanting to change or knowing for a fact that somewhere you changing yourself or somebody else, even if it's for the better, is going to hurt your ego. I don't believe that is going to be helpful to any person in the longer run.
That person should be far away from someone who's toxic, because these kind of statements where I cannot change, I will not change, that will hurt my ego. Those are horrible. That cannot even work in a family, in a friendship, or even if you're working for someone professionally, they would also expect you to change your work ethics and everything. Change is a part of life, and if you're not able to accept it,
absolutely.
God, may God bless.
Absolutely. So I believe, like you said, ki, this is not just about relationships or any of these toxic traits, but they eventually reflect on the rest of the parts of your life. May it be being a family person or in your work life, your academic life, you even a part of any social circle, if you will. So here, for example, since we're talking about introspecting and learning from our own faults, according to you, how can we identify from ourselves if we are the toxic one in a particular thing? And how do we identify, maybe, yes, this is a flaw that I have and this is something God-given and maybe I just need to find someone who aligns with that or who understands that, versus knowing that what I'm doing is wrong and I'm hurting somebody. And then how can I, or how can we as people work on it to be better human beings?
I think one should just stop and think whether you personally or I personally would be okay with my partner doing what I am about to do. Yeah. As in, with my, will I be okay if the other person starts exacting revenge or starts gaslighting me? If not, then, you know, put a brake on it. Get your shit together and actually own up to what you're doing wrong.
Okay.
It all depends on whether you would be okay with it, then proceed. And if still the other person's not okay with it, then it's on the other person to call you out and, you know, stop it. You can only do so much.
Absolutely. In fact, do you think there is a way for us to introspect and know our toxic traits even before we step into a relationship in general? I mean, we know ourselves, and most of us, or even us as human beings, we have the capacity to think. Most of us overthink. And I believe some of us have at least asked us once or twice about, is what I am doing, yeah, is it wrong? Or you could see that you're hurting the other person. So at least that thought must have crossed our minds, right? So how do you think it's possible for us to identify and prevent right from the start? And even though it is from the movie side, this person is doing this to the other person, I will never do that. So do you think it's possible for us to avoid being toxic right from the start before we are ever in a relationship?
No, to be honest, as I said, it's the journey of growing together. So, you know, you will realize, okay, this particular thing that I did hurt the other person. Realize that, oh, this thing hurts and I probably wouldn't do it again. That's how it goes. And even, you know, your first few relationships are bound to not be successful, not because the other person's not good for you or you're not good for them, but just because you're learning what you are supposed to do.
Right.
The friends you used to have back in KG, you're not friends with them, not because they were bad people, just because you grew, you liked someone else, you vibed with other people. That's about it. You grow about it.
That sounds really sensible to me. And going ahead, I want to request you, if you could read a little bit from your book, I would really love to know what you've written exactly.
Okay, so there's one poem in my book that sums up the whole book in general. It's about, you know, realizing that the other person's not good for you and taking the step to get out of that relationship quite reluctantly, and then realizing that it was for the best.
Right.
It was time for him to go. Solemnly, I walked into the fiery inferno. For a millennia, it seems, I trudged through the rings. For a millennia, it seems, I prayed for my sins. After inferno, which seemed century of years, in my paradise, I lay under the watchful twinkling stars.
Wow. I love the choice of words that you've used. It's really beautiful. And like you said, it does sum up pretty much the entire theme of the book. So I would have loved to engage in a much, much longer conversation about this, not only because the topic itself fascinates me. I also like to think about how humans react to toxicity in relationships in general. Unfortunately, since we are running out of time, I would like to ask you one last question, is that if you were to give a message or advice to everybody out there as to if we are the toxic ones, how can we avoid being that, or how can we amend the mistakes that we make? You know, understanding that, you accepting that, yes, I have done something wrong, is the first step, naturally. That is where everything falls into place afterwards. But when it comes to actually doing something about it, what do you think are the healthy ways you would like to tell people that if you are supposed to, or if you are to mend your toxic traits for your own betterment, how do you think it would help all of us?
I think the first step is owning up and acknowledging that you did it.
Yes.
Rather than blaming it on the other person for XYZ reason. No matter what the reason for your breakup is, when you break up, there might not, it might not be an equal fault, but both of them are at fault one way or the other, unless it's something related to abuse or cheating or something like that. But if there's a mutual breakup, or someone, you guys had an argument and you broke up, it's probably because both of you did have your boundaries set, probably had your walls up, you guys weren't meeting midway, one of them was reluctant and you built your walls because of that. And communication probably works the best. You communicate what you felt bad about or what you should have done, acknowledge, apologize, and kind of, to be honest, one should also accept the fact that not all relationships are supposed to work out. You can acknowledge, end on a happy note, and actually, you know, take the step back and just be.
Right. Just be happy for how long it lasted, actually. Right. And here, for example, I have noticed this a lot. People usually feel small when they apologize. Just like you said, the main part is acknowledging something. So along with that, do you think the apology also comes into the picture as a major, major thing, you know, actually having
it does. And actually, you pointed out my toxic trait. I hate apologizing. I hate apologizing and probably haven't really apologized ever. I do acknowledge that I'm wrong, but I don't say sorry, which is wrong also. But yeah, it does make people feel small initially, that I've seen. But once you actually start doing it, it probably is more comfortable. I mean, you apologize to your parents all the time. You don't feel small then. So you can do that for someone you claim to love.
Absolutely.
I'll try to do.
Yeah. I believe, yes, yes. All these things that you've mentioned are so apt, they are so relevant, and they make 100% sense. And I am excited. I'm literally jumping up and down just by that one poem that you recited. And I will be reading every poem, and I'm pretty sure I'll be texting you after I've read every poem as to how much I have loved this and how much I'm looking forward to more works than you. Well, it was amazing to have this conversation. I learned so much from you also. And it was brought to my notice so many things about modern day relationships in general, which I did not realize that had slipped my mind. They were there, but I hadn't actually given it a thought in that particular way. I can't wait to have more such discussions and conversations with you. Guys, this was Deepika Bharadwaj, the author of Subtle. Her book is available in paperback and ebooks formats on Amazon and the Ink Feathers bookstore. Please get your copies as soon as possible. Until then, please stay safe, please stay healthy. We will see you next time. Thank you so much.